Ciccatelli Associates Incorporated, CAI, is accredited by the Accreditation Council for Continuing Medical Education, ACCME, to provide continuing medical education for physicians. CAI designates this educational activity for a maximum of 2.5 AMA PRA Category 1 credits. Participants should only claim credit commensurate with the extent of their participation in the activity. If you would like a nursing or CME certificate, please make sure you have signed the sign-in sheet and submit an attendance verification form. This will confirm your attendance so that CAI can issue a CME or nursing certificate.
Welcome to the Title 10 broadcast series. This broadcast is brought to you by Ciccatelli Associates Incorporated, the Regional Training Center for Region 4, and the South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control's Family Planning Program. Before we get started, let's go over the procedures for registration, evaluations, and continuing education. Participants were required to register for today's broadcast on Ciccatelli's website at www.ciccatelli.org. All registered participants should be listed on the participant roster. If you've not yet registered for today's training, you can still register electronically through Ciccatelli's website. Participants were required to print out all the necessary paperwork for today's training, to include the PowerPoint presentation, evaluation form, demographic form, and the attendance verification form. All participants need to sign in and complete all the necessary information on the Ciccatelli sign-in form. You must sign in to make certain that you receive credit for attending today. At the end of today's broadcast, participants will need to complete the training evaluation form, participant demographic form, and the attendance verification form. Nurses and nurse practitioners wanting nursing continuing education contact hours must complete the attendance verification form. The nursing certificate applicants must be either a registered nurse or a nurse practitioner, and this certificate is blue. To receive a CME certificate, applicants must be a MD or a doctor of osteopathy. These participants will need to also complete the attendance verification form to receive a CME certificate, and this certificate is yellow. Social work hours have been provided by the South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control's Office of Social Work, and these certificates are gold and printed on half sheets. All other participants will receive a certificate of attendance, and this certificate is ivory. At the end of today's training, all required forms and extra certificates should be returned to the Family Planning Program in the self-addressed envelope that has been provided. Please be sure this is done within 2 weeks of this program. After DHET participants complete today's training and have received a certificate of attendance, they will be responsible for contacting their ELC coordinator to receive credit in the ELC. This training is set up in the ELC as a UDT course. Throughout the broadcast today, a fax number will appear at the bottom of the screen for questions, concerns, or situations that you would like for today's speaker to address during the question and answer segment. The fax number is 803-898-3816. If you have a question or concern after the broadcast, please email them to dhectv@dhec.sc.gov. Thank you for your time and attention, and we hope that you enjoy today's presentation.
Good morning. I'm Beth DeSantis, the Director of the Family Planning Program. I'd like to welcome you to today's training on mandatory reporting, South Carolina state laws. Before we get started, I need to go over the legislative mandates for Title 10. I'm sorry, but I have to read this word to word for you. Title 10 legislative mandates. The following legislative mandates have been part of the Title 10 appropriation language for each of the last several years. Title 10 Family Planning Services projects should include administrative, clinical, counseling, and referral services necessary to ensure adherence to these requirements. None of the funds appropriated in this act may be made available to any entity under the Title 10 of the Public Health Services Act unless the applicant for the award certifies to the secretary that it encourages family participation in the decision of minors to seek family planning services and that it provides counseling to minors on how to resist attempts to coerce minors into engaging in sexual activities. Notwithstanding any other provision of law, no provider of services under Title X of the Public Health Services Act shall be exempt from any state law requiring notification or the reporting of child abuse, child molestation, sexual abuse, rape, or incest. We are very fortunate to have with us today two dynamic and knowledgeable speakers. They will discuss the important topic of mandatory reporting. We will begin this morning with Cheryl Bullard, the Chief Counsel for Health Services. Cheryl will be discussing the state laws and reporting guidelines concerning child sexual abuse. Then, when we return from the morning break, we will have with us Rosalind Moses, the Director of Family Resource Center. Rosalind will be discussing some case studies on mandatory reporting. It is my great honor to be able to do the introduction of Cheryl Bullard. Cheryl currently serves as Chief Counsel for Health Services for South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control, advising the agency on issues affecting health service delivery, health policy, public health legal preparedness, privacy, and regulatory compliance, as well as probably some other things too. Mrs. Bullard has experience as a practicing nurse, nursing instructor, quality management director, and practicing attorney in both private and public agency practice. She has been a featured speaker at state and national conferences on emergency preparedness and other health law topics, including public health, ethical, and privacy issues. She is a member of the South Carolina Bar, the Health Law Council, the American Health Lawyers Association, and serves on the boards of the South Carolina Administrative and Regulatory Law Association and the South Carolina Women's Lawyers Association. She received a JD from the University of South Carolina in 1982 and a bachelor's in the science of nursing in 1975. Please help me welcome back Cheryl Bullard.
Thank you, Beth. Now I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome Beth to Central Office. We've had contact over the years on some of these very issues that we're going to be talking about today. So it's nice to have my telephone friend become an in-person friend now. So welcome, Beth. And good morning. Glad to be here, and I appreciate the very nice introduction. Today we're going to talk about mandatory reporting in teen sexuality and throw in a few other things related to HIPAA and some privacy concerns. So we, as we move through this, please, if you can, hold your questions until the end of the presentations, and we'll be glad to address those. Some of them may be addressed during the course of the presentation in a later slide or later discussion. And then my colleague, Rosalind, may be covering some of the issues that you want to ask about in the case studies. So again, thank you for being here, and I certainly appreciate the opportunity to address the group. I've been with DHEC since 1991, and every day has been a privilege to work with fantastic staff, dedicated folks that really have the best interest of the clients at heart, and I appreciate that so much. So thank you for a very, very wonderful opportunity for me. I need to tell you that I have no real or perceived vested interests that relate to this presentation, nor do I have any relationships with pharmaceutical companies, biomedical device manufacturers, and or other corporations whose products or services are related to pertinent therapeutic areas. The learning objectives that we're going to cover today. We're going to talk about sexual coercion and define that term, as well as sexual assault or sexual battery under South Carolina law. It's a battery is a touching, and assault is a fear of an attack. So we're going to talk about sexual battery more so than assault. We're going to talk about current state laws and reporting guidelines regarding sexual abuse. And we're also going to list the federal grant requirements regarding certification language and counseling on sexual coercion. Beth has already covered the actual Title X language that she was required to read to you. We're going to talk about that a little bit more in detail later in this presentation as well. I also need to tell you that somewhere during the review process, there were a few changes made on slides, particularly with dates. We don't know where they occurred, but we've tried to correct them on the PowerPoint that you're going to be seeing today. So please make the corrections on the slides that you printed before today's presentation. Most of them have to do with the dates that particular statutes were passed or a constitutional provision was on the ballot. We cannot have a discussion about sexuality of teenagers and the teenagers seeking health services and reporting of child abuse and neglect without talking about privacy and confidentiality laws. A number of these laws impact how we deal every day with our services to clients, with our interactions with clients and their families, and I just want to briefly touch on those. As all of you know, DHEC is a hybrid entity, which means some of our areas of the agency fall under the auspices of the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act privacy regulations, or HIPAA. The family planning services, to a degree that we have to charge something for those services, even on a sliding scale, make those services fall under the HIPAA privacy rules. Title X, of course, has their own confidentiality requirements for providing services to minors and others as well. We have minors laws that deal with how we can allow minors to access health services on their own without parental consent. And we have a way of treating those records as confidential when minors access the services on their own without a parent bringing them in. We also have the Child Protection Act. It's now been recodified to be the Children's Code or the Child Protection and Permanency parts of the code. There are different names for it, but I will always call it the Child Protection Act because that clearly defines exactly what it is. Parents' rights. We have a statute dealing with what kind of rights parents have with regard to access to records, educational records, and medical records that is separate and apart from the HIPAA privacy laws or the FERPA laws. We'll also touch briefly on FERPA. Those of you who have worked in an educational setting or with school nurses or have children in school probably have heard of FERPA or the Family Education Rights and Privacy Act. That's another set of federal regulations that deal with the privacy of information about students, whether they be in 18 and under or whether they're in college, 18 and over. We also have state agency policies which impact how we have to handle information about persons with whom we interact every day, to whom we provide services, and also give us some guidance on how to report certain activities. Now, I need to mention, I suppose, that the agency policy on reporting, mandatory reporting, and documenting is currently in the administrative review process. It's working its way up the chain, and we expect it to be rolled out shortly to all the areas. There's some sobering statistics that we need to mention just briefly. This information is from the CDC website. It's the most recent information that's posted on the website having to do with teen sexuality and sexually transmitted diseases, but they are very sobering statistics, and no one knows any better than our persons working in the regions that these actually may be understated as far as the percentages of teens engaged in sexual activity, the percentage of teens who actually contract sexually transmitted disease, and the types of sexual activity and alcohol and drug activity that is unfortunately running rampant. You can read these for yourself. I'm not going to waste your time, but these are taken directly from the CDC website. So certainly you can go to CDC and look under the teen sexuality, sexually transmitted disease tabs, and they will take you to a list of these statistics. I had checked just about a week and a half ago, and nothing's been updated as of then. So this has been out there a couple of years now. State laws relating to sexual activity of minors and the abuse of minors as it relates to sexual abuse. The South Carolina Child Protection Reform Act, as it was named in 1996, was amended in 2008 to completely renumber all provisions of the Children's Code. They are now contained in a complete title on their own, Title 63. It's an entire volume of the South Carolina Code of Laws. And it deals with all types of children's activities, from family court to child protection and permanency, placement, some criminal activity dealing with minors, but to a lesser degree than the criminal code. And it also addresses health services to minors. So all of those provisions that used to be, for those of you familiar and who have been around for a while, in Title 20, now are in Title 63. There are the criminal sexual conduct statutes, which includes criminal sexual conduct with a minor, and there's a 2006 amendment and a subsequent 2008 amendment, which changed those slightly, and we'll talk about that in more detail in just a few moments. We also have the South Carolina Constitution, which until November of 2008 set the constitutional age of consent for an unmarried female at 14. Several problems with that, which we'll talk about also. But the child protection statutes, in the preamble to those, it's stated that the primary goal of a child welfare agency is the protection of the safety and the welfare of the child. The child welfare agency in this state is the Department of Social Services. These statutes, according to the legislative intent, set forth the requirements for reporting known or suspected abuse or neglect. Now, including in that known abuse is sexual abuse as it relates to children. There are also procedural requirements set forth for permanence, for protection and removal of children, and these are predominantly the protection of children from the whatever is the subject of the abuse and neglect, such as a parent or a guardian or someone else who's in a authoritarian position over the child. But it also goes into great detail about how to remove children from an abusive setting or situation and the court procedures for doing that. One important point to make is that the Child Protection Act does not in and of itself have penalties or punishment for a person who commits a sexual offense or sexually abuses a child. What it does is rely on our state criminal statutes and laws to define and determine whether sexual abuse has actually occurred. Now, a critical point in that segment of the law is to remember, and I always stress this to people when I talk to them about particular scenarios dealing with child abuse or neglect. We defer to the state criminal laws to determine whether or not abuse has actually occurred with regard to an allegation of sexual abuse. Now, what that means is it is within the jurisdiction of the state criminal professionals, whether it be local law enforcement, sheriffs, the solicitor of the jurisdiction, even the Attorney General's office, to determine whether or not a crime has been occurred. It is not the obligation, nor should it be even inferred to any of our staff, that it is up to you to investigate whether or not an offense has actually occurred. So please keep that in mind. Children's Code definitions. So where do we find out what is actual how abuse is defined? That's in 63-7-20 of the Children's Code. A child is any person under the age of 18, according to the statute. Now, is that a hard and fast rule? As far as it defines what the age of a minor is, yes. As far as it determines the seriousness of a crime or what kind of punishment would be made or when a child is actually considered not really an adult, but a person who is competent enough to make decisions for their own, is in other places throughout the code. But for all practical purposes, though, under this section of the law, a child is a person under the age of 18, unless it's somewhere otherwise specified. Child abuse and neglect or harm to a child occurs when a parent, guardian, or other person responsible for a child's welfare inflicts or allows to be inflicted upon the child physical or mental injury, or engages in acts or omissions which present a substantial risk of physical or mental injury to a child. Does that mean that someone other than a parent, guardian, or person responsible for the child's welfare cannot commit child abuse? No. Obviously not. Any person can be accused of child abuse. The difference, as it's distinguished in law, is to whom you report those types of events. If it's a person responsible for a child's welfare, which includes the parent, guardian, foster parent, operator, employee, or caregiver of a public or private residential home, institution, agency, or child care facility, or an adult who has assumed the role or responsibility of a parent or guardian for the child, but does not necessarily have legal custody, then those reports go to DSS. It does not apply to a person who has only casual or incidental contact, such as a babysitter. Now, sexual abuse is defined as the commission of this act by a parent, guardian, or other person responsible for the child's welfare, or someone else outside of that realm. So it applies not only to persons in a familial role or a custodial role, it also applies to persons who do not fall in that role, but who may be a boyfriend, who may be, unfortunately, a drug supplier, any kind of relationship with that child, and even an acquaintance or someone who doesn't even know the child. Sexual abuse, though, as it's defined in the Children's Code, is someone who commits or allows to be committed against the child a sexual offense, and here is where it refers to the laws of the state that define what a sexual offense is. So, a person who commits or allows to be committed against the child a sexual offense as defined by the laws of this state, or engages in acts or omissions that present a substantial risk that a sexual offense as defined by the laws of the state would be committed against the child. Again, the sexual offenses are defined in the criminal code. That's Title 16 of the South Carolina Code of Laws. Criminal sexual conduct is defined as occurring in the first, second, third degrees. Criminal sexual conduct with a minor is first and second degree only. Now, why is that important? For your purposes, it's not. For criminal law purposes, it's important because it defines the elements that have to be committed for a particular crime in order for a prosecution to take place. Not up to you to investigate that. Secondly, it determines what punishment a person will endure if they are convicted of a particular offense. Some are misdemeanors, some are felonies. So again, the seriousness of the crime is what determines under our state law what kind of penalty a perpetrator might suffer. Now, the sexual offense could be engaging, directing, or promoting a child for sexual performance. It could be incest. It could be sexual assault or battery. Remember in the beginning we talked about an assault is not actually attacking somebody, it's a fear of attack, and a battery is an actual touching. Committing a lewd act upon a child, completely separate section of the criminal code in its own. Prostitution, which also could fall under engaging, directing, or promoting a child for a sexual performance, but not necessarily so. And sexual exploitation. These are just examples of some of the sexual offenses dealing with children. Now, let's go into a little more detail about what is criminal sexual conduct with a minor. That statute is found in 16-3-655. It defines what criminal responsibility is, but it also covers mitigating circumstances, which we'll talk about in a few moments. First degree criminal sexual conduct, as defined by our code of laws, is sexual battery with a victim less than 11 years old, or sexual battery with a victim less than 16, and the person who's committing the offense has previously been convicted or has pled guilty or no contest to an offense or has been ordered to be included on a sexual offender registry. Secondly, second degree criminal sexual conduct occurs if the sexual battery is with a victim 14 or less, but at least 11. The third element is it's criminal sexual conduct in the second degree if sexual battery occurs if the victim is less than 16 and the accused or the accused perpetrator is in a position of familial, custodial, or official authority to coerce the victim to submit or is older than the victim. Official authority, custodial, all a matter of legal interpretation. Older than the victim is not defined. It could be one day older, 1 month older, 5 years older. It's just older than the victim is the way the law reads. Now, elements of second degree criminal sexual conduct with a minor is the actor engages in a sexual battery with a victim who's 14 or less, but at least 11, or with a victim who's at least 14, but less than 16, and the actor's in a familial, custodial, or official position with the ability to coerce the victim to submit or is older than the victim. Now, this language was quoted in State versus Warren, which was a criminal case when a person in a familial capacity was actually convicted of criminal sexual conduct with a child, a relative. Exception, I'll go back to that just a moment. I'll try to go back to that. The State versus Warren is a case from 1998. We're going to talk about a couple of other civil cases, not in a criminal context, but this is one that is more recent than some of the others that are on the books and does use this language actually in the court opinion. An exception to second degree criminal sexual conduct is a person may not be convicted, and these are critical words, may not be convicted of a violation of the provisions of this item if he is 18 or less when he engages in consensual sexual conduct with another person who's at least 14. Now the language may not be convicted is critical. It does not say he may not be charged. It does not say he may not be accused. It does not say he may not be investigated. What it says is if those events have occurred and it's determined by law enforcement that someone has engaged in consensual sexual activity, which falls into this definition in the criminal code, then a jury cannot, or a judge cannot convict them of the activity. So it's an important distinction to make. Now remember, while some of you may be aware, there is pending legislation to change this so that it would not be a reportable event if there's information to believe that it's consensual activity by persons providing services or who are mandatory reporters. That amendment or that change in the law has been proposed. It's sitting in the legislature. It has not moved through committee. At least it hadn't as of the end of yesterday. And I don't expect it to go anywhere this legislative session. We were hoping that the legislature would take some action, but they have other agenda items that they consider high priority, so it has not been addressed as of yet. And I honestly don't expect it to, but I would love to be proven wrong, because we do need some guidance. Now, criminal sexual conduct in the third degree is another statute that actually precedes the one we were just talking about, a criminal sexual conduct with a minor. But it's important because it addresses a sexual battery against the victim, and if any one of the following circumstances are proven: that the actor uses force or coercion, that the actor knows or has reason to know that the victim is mentally defective or somehow incapacitated or physically helpless, and force or coercion was not used. Now, this is important because if an actor knows that someone is incapacitated or lacks capacity to consent, then this statute may also be invoked in order to pursue a criminal charge against an individual in a sexual conduct case with a minor. It would just be another statutory provision to prove and additional elements to establish. So how are these terms defined? Sexual battery is defined as sexual intercourse or other sexual activity or any intrusion, however slight, of any part of a person's body, of any object, into a genital or anal opening of the person's body, unless it's for medical purposes, such as a physical exam that an obstetrician, a gynecologist might conduct, or a colonoscopy. Obviously, is not going to be something that is a sexual battery, but for the exception that's put forth in the law, it might be considered to be. But again, what is central in all of these types of activities is that there must be an actual touching for this to take place, as opposed to an assault. Aggravated coercion is also defined in the law. The actor threatens to use force or violence of a high and aggravated nature to overcome a victim or another person if the victim reasonably believes that the actor has the present ability. And what does that mean? That means that right now, at that time, when the actor is attempting to coerce the victim to do something that would be a violation of law, that they actually have the ability at that time, and the victim believes that they have that ability to carry through with that coercive activity. Or they could threaten to retaliate in the future in the infliction of physical harm, kidnapping, or extortion under circumstances of aggravation against the victim or any other person. Now, when an allegation of coercion is alleged, if there's an allegation of coercion, in order to prove that there has been coercion or aggravated coercion, these are the elements that the solicitor or the attorney prosecuting a case has to establish in order for that person to meet the burden of proof. Statutory rape. I mention this because, one of our central topics today is the consent. What is the age of consent, and how does one consent to sexual activity? Statutory rape is not defined in case law, often not defined in statute in South Carolina, but it is often referenced in case law. It is, however, defined by federal entities such as the FBI and other law enforcement, which our law enforcement relies on in order to interpret what is actual statutory rape. Generally, it's a term used in some legal jurisdictions to describe consensual sexual relations with an individual who's not old enough to legally consent to the behavior. Under the FBI definition, illegal sexual activity between two people, when it would otherwise be legal if not for their age, and it's characterized by non-forcible sexual intercourse with a person who's younger than the statutory age of consent. Statutory rape is also defined as sex between an adult and a sexually mature minor past the age of puberty. So why would that be? An adult and a child or a sexually mature minor under just about any jurisdiction in the United States is not allowed. Even though our state law doesn't have a specific age range, as we talked about a few minutes ago, where statutory rape would be applicable. Now, the age of consent, always a hot topic of debate. It's not defined in South Carolina law, but again, we defer to the state criminal code about what minors can and can't consent to. And we also have case law available to us that gives us guidance about how the courts interpret the age of consent and when a young person can legally consent to sexual activity. And we'll talk about a couple of those cases in a few moments. The age of consent and how it's defined depends on where you live, what the definition of sex is in that jurisdiction, and the various laws depending on difference in ages of partners, like we just talked about with regard to the criminal sexual conduct statutes. Some states, some nations do define what the age of consent is, and it varies. And there's a website that you can go to with just put in age of consent, and it will come up with a national, international chart of what the various ages of consent are around the world. And they actually, for the most part, I think, are pretty common. The age of consent is generally between 14 and 16, but not always that. And I would caution you when you look up any kind of document like that and you're looking for your own jurisdiction, do not rely on the accuracy of that information. It's generally not a survey that's conducted by somebody in our state who is familiar with our state laws and the full gamut of our state laws, but it may be something that they've looked for and not been able to really put the hands on, so it might be a guesstimate. So I would caution you, if you're relying on that research, please pay attention to either the source of the material or do your own research if you've got to have something specific for your own jurisdiction. Now, the age of consent is an age at which a young person is legally able to understand and agree to consensual sexual activity. Again, it depends on where you live, and that by that I mean the jurisdiction that you live in or the country you live in. Until November 4th of 2008, when we had a ballot dealing with our constitutional provision, it was 14 and up in South Carolina. If you relied on the constitutional provisions in order to establish age of consent. But for a number of reasons, that constitutional provision was probably, more than likely, and I would say absolutely, not would not pass judicial muster because it was probably unconstitutional. Because what it said was no unmarried woman shall legally consent to sexual intercourse who shall not have attained the age of 14 years. It's not gender neutral, and it's not marriage neutral. That's what it said prior to November 4th of 2008. The constitutional change, which was on the November 2008 ballot, gave voters the right to delete the constitutional provision setting the age at which an unwed girl can consent to sex. The amendment stated, the question to the voters stated, must that section of the Constitution of South Carolina be amended so as to delete the provision that an unmarried woman shall legally consent to sexual intercourse who shall not have attained the age of 14 years. Voters overwhelmingly voted that constitutional provision should be deleted. So what was the impact of that? Deleting the section allowed the state legislature to set the age of consent. Currently, they have set the age of consent at the age of 16 for most cases, but again, that's all in the criminal context. The legislature has not yet acted to define an age of consent for civil purposes or for reporting purposes under the mandatory child reporting statutes. Don't expect it to happen this year again. don't know that it will ever happen, but the legislature has not acted on that constitutional change. Under the constitutional provision that was voted on in 2008, the legislators could not make, or under the existing constitutional provisions, legislators couldn't make the age of legal consent less than 14, but they did have the discretion to set it above the age of 14. Now, there's no limit in the Constitution restricting the age that legislators could set for a girl to give legal consent. Now let's move on to the reporting, mandatory reporting statutes, and who is required to report abuse or neglect under the Child Protection Act. Physicians, nurses, dentists, optometrists, medical examiners, coroners, employees of medical examiners and coroners, medical personnel, EMS, mental health, allied health counselors, clergy, including a Christian Science practitioner or a religious healer, which is interesting as the way it's defined here, because we're going to talk about some contradictory language in a later statute a little bit later, but note that clergy is required to report. Persons to go on to other persons, school teachers, counselors, principals, assistant principals, social or public assistance workers, substance abuse treatment staff, child care workers, police or law enforcement, undertakers, funeral home directors, film processors, those folks who take their pictures to CVS or Rite Aid or wherever they take them to be, Walgreens, to be developed. Those people are required to report if they see something that is looks like child pornography or illicit activity. A judge. When must a report be made? A report must be made in accordance with this section when in the person's, and the critical language, professional capacity, the person has received information which gives the person reason to believe that a child has been or may be abused or neglected as defined in the Child Protection Act, which is in section 63-7-310. Now, remember that the professional must make a professional determination within that person's capacity, but the professionals that we're talking about in our agency and any child welfare agency or medical provider context are not criminal investigators. So we have whatever information the client gives us or that we're able to develop because of either history that we know or some other third party might give us information, but please, please do not ever think that you are the person who's responsible for investigation of whether or not the activity is actually occurring or anything else about proving the elements of the crime. Where to report? To DSS if that person is a parent, guardian, or other person who is committing the offenses. However, you report to law enforcement if the acts that are defined in the statute as abuse or harm were committed by some other person. Now, law enforcement and DSS are charged by law with working cooperatively with one another on reports. In the event you have any doubt that a report is being followed through with, you always act in the best interest of the protection of the child, and that I advise to report to both law enforcement and DSS if you have any suspicion or thought that the abuse might not be followed through, the abuse allegation might not be followed through with. The law allows you to report orally by telephone or otherwise to a county DSS or law enforcement in the county where the child is located. And law enforcement and DSS must communicate on reports. But you know, and I know, that many times law enforcement or DSS will not take an oral report. All I can do is tell you the law allows for oral reports to be made. The law allows for anonymous reports to be made. However, there's a caveat to that. Law enforcement or DSS has to know who to contact in order to get additional information, if any is available, or they need testimony in court. A reporter cannot be identified in court as the person who made the report, according to our state law. And there's immunity from liability if a reporter is acting in good faith on reliable or credible information. And remember, you don't have to ascertain with certainty that there is an abuse or neglect situation occurring. All you have to do is have a reasonable suspicion within that person's professional capacity or judgment. Now, here's where I want to talk a little bit about the confusion or the difference to the extent it exists between the mandatory reporting law and the privileged communications. There's an abrogation of privileged communications between a husband and wife and a doctor and patient. What does that mean? Because a doctor has a relationship with a patient, or a husband has and a wife have a marital relationship, there's no privilege for testifying against the person who is suspected or known to be engaging in child abuse, sexual abuse, whatever kind of abuse. There's no privilege there. So if a spouse is known to be committing an activity, and the spouse of that person who's the innocent spouse is called to testify, they cannot assert a privilege and say, you can't make me testify against my husband, or you can't make me testify against my wife. Now remember, clergy are required reporters, but there is a statute in the Children's Code which says a communication between a client and a clergy is protected under that clergy impenitent privilege, or the priest impenitent privilege, which begs the question, how is a member of the clergy a mandatory reporter if there's a privilege? And the only way I can resolve that is if a clergy person, priest, minister, whomever, becomes aware that an abuse may or is known to be occurring in the community, in the church, and the person who's responsible for that activity has not personally confessed to the priest, a priest, about the activity, then the clergy would be required to report. But that's the only way I can resolve that distinction, and I still don't believe it's strong enough to prevent the report from being made. There are penalties for failure to report. There's a fine of not more than $500 or imprisonment for not more than 6 months, or both, if there's a failure to report. And unfortunately, and I think Beth, you can speak to this, our staff people have been accused of a failure to report by law enforcement and threatened with prosecution for not reporting minors' sexual activity. There are penalties for knowingly making false statements. There's a fine of not more than $5,000 or imprisonment for no more than 90 days, or both, a cumulative penalty, for making a false report if you know it to be false. And there's also penalties for malicious and bad faith reporting. In addition to the penalties that you can have under the Child Protection Act for civil criminal penalties, there could also be a civil suit for actual and punitive damages for a false or malicious or bad faith report. South Carolina case law that I want to talk about is related to civil suits that have been involving persons who have engaged in sexual activity with minors. Now, remember that I mentioned earlier the age of consent is not specifically defined in our state law. However, when state law does not clearly define something for us, then we look to case law to provide guidance as to how particular statutes would be interpreted and how the judicial branch of the government would interpret something if the legislature has failed to be specific. This is one of those cases, Doe versus Greenville Hospital System, which you'll see is from the South Carolina Court of Appeals from 1994. So it's 16 years old now. In this case, a minor plaintiff and her father sued a hospital, obviously it's Greenville Hospital System, after a male employee sexually assaulted the minor patient at the hospital. There was a jury instruction in that case that an unmarried female under the age of 16 could not legally consent to sexual intercourse with an adult in a civil assault and battery case. Now, this extends from the criminal arena to the civil arena, what the court has determined to be the age of consent. Now, why is this language significant? An unmarried female under the age of 16 can't legally consent. What did our Constitution say? Unmarried female under the age of 14. That provision was in effect in 1994, but the judicial branch was already saying the legislature, in our reading of all the criminal statutes, has defined the age of consent at 16. This is not new. This has been in effect for a period of time. But until the constitutional provision was done away with by the general vote, public vote, then we relied on that constitutional provision in order to make a defense against our staff people if we needed to. And the court went on to say, as a matter of public policy, the General Assembly has determined that a minor under the age of 16 is not capable of voluntarily consenting to a sexual battery or sexual touching that is committed by an older person. And it cites to this statute that has been slightly amended in the last 4 years. And the court said, this is the law of the state, whether it is applied in a civil or a criminal context. Now, it also quotes the other statute referring to an older person and does not, even in case law, define the older person. Further, the issue before the jury was whether the hospital negligently hired or supervised an employee who committed a criminal act against the plaintiff. Thus, the criminal statute is applicable to this civil lawsuit. It was not a crime that was being prosecuted in this case. It was a suit for damages against the hospital. The second case that I want to mention to you is Doe versus Orangeburg County School District. Again, it is a civil case, and it is from the state Supreme Court in 1999. A female high school student in Orangeburg County and her mother sued the school, alleging she was raped by another student. The court stated, in their opinion, the rule that a victim under the age of 16 is legally incapable of consenting to sexual battery committed by an older person applies in both the criminal and the civil context. And again, they cited the same criminal statute that we talked about earlier with criminal sexual conduct with a minor. This was a situation in which the victim was accusing another student of raping her in the bathroom. In a footnote, the court stated this: the South Carolina Constitution also prohibits an unmarried female's consent. And again, they quote the constitutional provision here, which says, no unmarried woman shall legally consent to sexual intercourse who shall not have attained the age of 14. And given our constitutional provision, we concur with the Court of Appeals holding in Doe that the prohibition on consent applies in both criminal and civil context. And again, this court also considered 16 to be the age of consent. Now let's move on to some of the other privacy issues with regard to health services for minors. Under a provision that has been in law for a long time in this state, minors 16 and over can consent to health services other than operations. Now, why is this important? With regard to Title 10, we have to provide services to minors of any age if they come and ask us to do that. And that's what we want to do. That's one of our missions, to do that. And the state law allows us as well to provide services to minors without parental consent. The statute actually says any minor who's reached the age of 16 may consent to any health services from a person authorized by law to render the health service for himself or herself, and the consent of no other person shall be necessary unless there's a surgical procedure involved. And in that case, the statute sets out what parameters have to be met in order for parents not to have to consent to a surgical case. And that is the operation or the procedure is essential to the health or life of the child in the opinion of the physician who's going to perform the procedure and a consultant physician, if one's available. Sometimes in emergency situations, there may not always be a consultant physician available. Now, even more importantly, there's another statute which says certain health services can be rendered to minors of any age, not just under not just 16 and over, without the consent of a parent or legal guardian, when in the judgment of a person authorized by law to render the particular health services, the services are deemed necessary. Again, unless that involves an operation which shall be performed only if it's essential to the health or life of the child. But what's critical about this particular statute is it covers minors of any age, does not define a cutoff age, and we also have an Attorney General opinion which dates back to 1975-76 fiscal year, that a legitimate provider of health services may provide any health services, including family planning services, which do not involve an operation to a minor under 16 years of age without that minor's parents' or guardian's consent. So any age child who comes to us for a health service, family planning, STD checks, just to talk for counseling, evaluation, we can provide that service without the minor's parent or guardian consenting to that. Again, it's the same type of language. The services are necessary to maintain well-being of the child, and the type of services involved must be the professional decision of the provider involved. Now, obviously, our physicians, our nurse practitioners, our nurses are persons who stand in a position to have the professional capacity to determine whether or not a service is necessary, such as family planning and STDs. Now, I'm going to review for just a moment some of the points that Beth covered earlier when she was giving you the litany from the family planning regulations. DHEC, of course, is the Title X provider in this state. There are federal requirements, such as set out by Beth, but they go far beyond that, for us or the agency to be able to receive funding to provide those services. One of the requirements is that we have to provide services to minors of any age. Another is that those services must be provided confidentially. The grant sets forth or establishes that the services must be voluntary, under voluntary family planning projects, including natural family planning methods, infertility services, services for adolescents. We have to also provide these services without regard to religion, race, color, national origin, handicapping condition, including incompetence, age, sex, the number of pregnancies, or the marital status of the individual who seeks the services. Some of the critical points to remember is the services must be solely on a voluntary basis. This is the voluntary basis of the person seeking the services. We've had instances where a parent has brought a child in and wants that child to be on birth control or DEPO, something. I don't think we have that much of an issue anymore with that, but certainly not with Norplant, but still parents do want DEPO, I think, and we cannot provide that to the child if the child's refusing. Under our federal guidelines, we cannot do that. Parents get irate, as you all know, and upset with us, but we have federal rules that we have to follow. We cannot coerce them into using any particular kind of family planning. Client confidentiality must be assured. No information can be disclosed without the individual's written consent, except as required by law or as necessary to provide services. Now, one of those ways that we have to violate a person's request for confidentiality is reporting of abuse. And that is clearly set out in the federal regulations. No client of ours has the right to the expectation of confidentiality under the law if there has been an allegation or suspicion of abuse. Funds are not available to programs where abortion is a method of family planning. That continues to be the case to this day. Title 10 requirements continued. The client has to be assured that the counseling services are confidential. Remember, there are exceptions to that, one of them being abuse, other mandatory reporting requirement. Counselors should encourage, under the federal guidelines, family participation, one of the critical components. The client must be counseled on resisting attempts to be coerced into sexual activity. Again, written consent of parents or guardians cannot be required. Now, can a child ask that their parent be included? Certainly, and that's encouraged. Go back to the second bullet. Counselors should encourage family participation, but you cannot force it. Parents or guardians can't be notified before or after a minor has requested and received Title 10 family planning services. Now, one of the issues we have, which creates a problem for us, is if we bill Medicaid for a client service and it's sent to the Medicaid intermediary in this state, by their federal regulations, they must try to collect from a private insurer who covers that child. So what's the effect of that? The parent finds out that their insurance company has been billed for a service that the client has received in the health department, and they want to know what that service is. We cannot give them that information. We did not bill their insurance company. DHHS billed their insurance company. We cannot give them any portion of the child's record. We always have to refer them to either the insurance company or to DHHS for resolution of that issue. But it has been a problem in more than a few cases where a parent has learned that a child accessed confidential services only because their insurance company was billed, not by us. Now, adolescent services. The child must be informed about all methods of contraception, or the person seeking our family planning services. Abstinence, contraceptive, and safer sex practices must be discussed. It is important and critical, I would stress, that we not assume adolescents are sexually active if they request family planning services. The counseling should prepare them to use a variety of methods effectively if and when they are ready to begin some contraceptive services. If you think way back at the beginning, we mentioned FERPA, which is the Family Educational Rights to Privacy Act. These laws address educational records, and they are defined as those directly related to a student maintained by an educational agency or an institution or a party acting for that entity. They do not include records that are kept in the sole possession of the maker, and that might be the school nurse, that are used only as a personal memory aid, not accessible or revealed to any other person. And they may be just a temporary substitute for perhaps a later recorded recollection in an educational record. If the child is under 18, parents have to consent to the release of educational records. We do not have access to those as health providers. If we have a relationship with a nurse and that school medical record or health record of the child is considered to be part of their educational record, we have to have parental consent to get that information. So There are confidentiality laws that may inhibit some of the interaction that you might have had previously with school nurses about a child's medical needs or health needs. So just keep in mind that FERPA, not HIPAA, might be the culprit there in preventing you from getting information. And also remember that if you send documents or information to the educational institution, to the school nurse, and that school nurse incorporates information that is sent to the school nurse from our health records, even with the consent of the child, they may be included in the educational record of the child. So the parent then has access. So just keep that in mind for protection of child's confidentiality. Now, under the FERPA rules, an educational institution shall give full rights to either parent unless, as a family court order, state statute, or other legally binding document relating to such matters specifically revoking the parent's rights. Just because they don't have custody of the child does not do away with their rights to get access to information. The rights transfer to the students at the age of majority or 18. So if there's a health record for a college students over 18, parents don't have to consent to the release of that information, and parents don't have access to that information, only if the child gives them access. As a parent of a college-age son, I can't get his grades unless he wants me to. And that FERPA also gives them the right to protect the privacy with regard to what kind of grades they're making in school. Now, I don't have to agree to pay his tuition if he won't provide me with information, but nevertheless, they do have that right, even if you're paying the bills. Now, there's a South Carolina law on parents' rights and access to information, and that's also in the Children's Code, 63-5-30. The mother and father are joint natural guardians of their minor children and are equally charged with the welfare and education of their minor children. And the mother and father have equal powers, rights, and duties, and neither parent has any right paramount to the right of the other concerning custody of the minor. Each parent, whether custodial or not, has equal access to educational and medical records. Now, what's the caveat to that? Parents cannot access family planning records or other health services records when the child has accessed that service or requested that service on their own behalf, and they're allowed under law, or it's provided under law, that they can have confidential services such as family planning or STD testing and treatment. And parents will argue, as most of you probably know, that if they don't, if we deny access to a minor client's record, they get quite a rate. Have them call me, and they do. Now, one other confidentiality statute I just wanted to briefly mention, as any of you who work in STD clinics know, 4429-135 says, and this is the strictest of state laws with regard to confidentiality of information, all reports and information are strictly confidential, cannot be released pursuant to subpoena and otherwise. And I want to stress, it's not just reports or our records, it's any information we have about a known or suspected STD cannot be released pursuant to subpoena or otherwise. 5 exceptions, most of which are discussed in Regulation 6121 of our South Carolina state laws. The exception in this case, just as in all others, is reports regarding child abuse. Remember that if we make a report, if an STD has been diagnosed in a child, we provide information from that child's record that is pertinent to the report, and that is all we can provide. We cannot provide any access to any information about who we think or know might be the perpetrator of the report, whether or not there are positive test results about that individual. There's another process that law enforcement can pursue if they need to get that information, but we cannot disclose it without consent. So remember the provisions about STD records. There's required reporting of child abuse sexual abuse. Only the name of the minor and medical information concerning the minor can be reported, and reports have to be made to the appropriate agency. Now, court order disclosures are covered under another statute, 4429-136. There must be a court procedure. A lot of solicitors don't know what it is. So if you get some law enforcement person showing up, investigator demanding records, most of you have us on speed dial. So please give us a call, and we deal with those types of issues every day. But unless you've got a court order that's met all of the legal requirements, we're not going to release that information. In fact, we just dealt with one last week that was a problem court order, but we're trying to resolve that now. And all of these are just provisions about what the legal requirements are for those. I want to thank you very much for your attention. We will take questions at a later time, but right now we're going to take a 10-minute break. And thank you again. Thank you.